In November of 2020, the Netflix hit series The Crown released its fourth season. This series, with the returning cast from season 3, would cover Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II's reign from 1979 to 1990. The series featured many prominent characters such as Margaret Thatcher, Michael Flanagan, and Princess Diana. However, something piqued my interest when the series was first announced was the 1983 Royal Tour of Australia and New Zealand. I began to wonder if the series would mention arguably Australia's most beloved Prime Minister, Bob Hawke. If so, how would the series bring him to life? Which historical events would he be seen in? I began to think that maybe he would be featured on the tour when he met His Royal Highness the Prince of Wales at the Lodge in Canberra, or maybe at the Commonwealth of Nations meeting. And I may have even pushed my luck by thinking this, but by thinking there might be a mention of the opening of Parliament House in 1988, which the Queen herself attended. Either way, I was waiting for the series and I was excited. For those of you who don't know, Bob Hawke was Australia's 23rd Prime Minister and served from 1983 and 1991. He was a member of the Labour Party. Hawke was quite the character, a larrikin and a leader. Before he was a member for Parliament, he was a member of the Australian Council of Trade Unions, or ACTU. Hawke is also famous for his world record for drinking 2.5 pints of beer in 11 seconds. He rose through the ranks and served as president throughout 1970 to 1980. In 1980, he contested the seat of Willis, Victoria, and won. He was now a member of Parliament for the Labour Party. In 1983, he became leader of the opposition and ran against Prime Minister Malcolm Fraser in the 1983 election and won in a landslide victory. Now, there is a lot to talk about with Bob Hawke, but for time purposes, I'm only going to really talk about what is absolutely relevant with The Crown. However, maybe for another video, I'll talk about Bob Hawke in more detail and his role in Australian politics and history. Hawke won 4 general elections and invested the Labour Party with a governing ethos that had rarely displayed before in national politics. Lucky to have a talented cabinet, Hawke presided over a historic shift in Australia from a protectionist to a free trade economy and the embrace of a market-based reforms that reshaped the economy and increased national prosperity. In office, he had an abiding interest in global events and ran a foreign policy that deepened its ties with Asia, notably China, and renewed the US alliance. Bob set several economic and social reforms throughout his term and won the hearts of the Australian people. This continued well after he was no longer Prime Minister. Let's move on to fact versus fiction. Now, we must understand that The Crown is a show, and therefore is able to take creative liberties in order to make the show engaging. However, the show's portrayal of Bob Hawke leaves much to be desired. The Crown portrays him as rude, condescending, hateful, and downright narcissistic. Now, the episode in which we first see Hawke is episode 6, Terra Nullius. Right at the beginning of the episode, we see Hawke, who is in an interview for Channel 4. The episode itself takes place in early 1983, when the Prince and Princess of Wales toured Australia and New Zealand. The title, Terra Nullius, refers mainly to The Crown's controversial storyline between Hawke, played by Richard Roxburgh, and the royal family. Thank you, Sir Jim. A Republican, Hawke spends the episode hoping for a disastrous royal visit, which would then allow Australia to leave the Commonwealth and become a republic. But the one thing Hawke hadn't counted on was the effectiveness of Princess Diana. While the real Bob Hawke wasn't the perfect man, and he did do things that were quite wrong, he never despised the monarchy as represented in the show. In the first interview, for instance, you can tell the creative liberties that were taken. Firstly, The Crown didn't get the date right for the interview, which shows how much research they did. And they say that the interview took place on the 26th of February, but it was in fact in the 12th. The ABC actually went back through the archives and found the program and saw it was on, in fact, the 12th. The show makes him appear condescending to Prince Charles and show him flat out insulting the Queen. This never happened. Let's now watch the two interviews, the first being the interview we see in The Crown, and the second interview being the one that was actually aired on national television.
Bob, If you win the election next week, which all the polls predict, one of your first public acts as Prime Minister will be to welcome Prince Charles and the Princess of Wales and young Prince William. Does that prospect fill you with enthusiasm?
I don't regard it as the most important thing I'm going to have to do in the first month in office. Yes, they are coming. I've had the opportunity of meeting Charles on a number of occasions. I find him a nice young bloke.
Is he the sort of man you'd like to be the King of Australia?
Look, I don't think we'll be talking about kings or monarchy here in Australia much longer. You know, we're past that now, aren't we? We're a bit more mature. You know my position on this. It's no secret. I respect and admire the Queen enormously. The desire is simply to have a head of state that embodies and represents Australia's values and traditions. A head of state that looks like us, sounds like us, thinks like us.
As opposed to?
Well, one of them, a POM. You know, an unelected non-Australian who lives on the other side of the world and for all their good intentions is a different breed. You wouldn't put a pig in charge of a herd of prime beef cattle, even if it did look good in a twin set of pearls.
Tonight, for the first Four Corners programme for 1983, we talked to Mr. Bob Hawke before an audience in Melbourne. One of your first public acts, I expect it will be undertaken if you win office, will be to welcome Prince Charles and the Princess of Wales and young Prince William. Does that prospect fill you with enthusiasm?
Well, I don't regard it as the most important thing I'm going to have to do in the first month of office, but they are coming. They've been invited. I've had the opportunity of meeting Prince Charles on a number of occasions. I find him a nice young bloke. No, I'm not being conscious.
Is he the sort of man you'd like to be King of Australia?
I don't think we'll be talking about kings of Australia forevermore.
How soon might we stop?
Something that's going to be imposed. I just have a feeling. I don't dodge this question. I believe that we'd be better off as a republic. But I don't think it's a matter of great importance. The thing that concerns me is the condition of men and women out there in Australia, and particularly the people in poverty, the disadvantaged. And if we became a republic tomorrow, it wouldn't improve their condition one iota. But I think in terms of being our own country, that the time will come when Australians would prefer to be a republic. I don't think it's number one issue on the agenda. And when Prince Charles and Princess Diana come, they've been invited, and they will receive all the courtesies and all the treatment that is appropriate to their position and their relationship with this country.
Bob Hawke, if you win the election next week, which all the polls predict, one of your first public acts as Prime Minister will be to welcome Prince Charles and the Princess of Wales and young Prince William. Does that prospect fill you with enthusiasm?
I don't regard it as the most important thing I'm going to have to do in the first month in office. Yes, they are coming. I've had the opportunity of meeting Charles on a number of occasions. I find him a nice young bloke.
Let's stop it right there for a second. Apart from a few creative liberties taken in regards to the speech that he said, nothing much has changed. That's not a problem. When it's speaking, it's making it more engaging. I don't see a problem with that. But this bit where the condescending look on his face, the basically trying to look like he's trying to get a reaction out of Prince Charles, that never happened. And we can see in the actual interview where he says, I'm not trying to be condescending. And he goes on to say he does believe he's a nice bloke, but he's cut off by the person doing the interview. Now, the reason why the Crown's trying to do this, it makes logical sense. They're trying to
build, stir it up for the episode, trying to get people's intrigue, trying to get them interested. So they're trying to start a conflict between the Prime Minister and the heir to the throne, Prince Charles, the Crown. All he's done so far is say that Prince Charles is a good bloke, but in a very condescending way. So that's our first thing. But it does get worse further on, and we'll look into that. And even describe himself as a favourite Prime Minister. In regards to the insult, Hawke never would have said that. This we know, because again, it's on film. The Australian newspaper, The Guardian, says it very well, actually. So here's where the quote begins. The truth is, Hawke never regarded the Republic as a first-order issue, especially 1983, as an incoming Prime Minister with a big agenda of economic recovery and reform. He was not into the politics of symbolism. He also recognised the Queen's popularity in Australia and saw no reason to waste time or capital trying to change that. Over time, he came up with a formula response that the push for an Australian head of state should await the death of Elizabeth, a courtesy for her and a dig at Charles, whom he dismissed as a nice young bloke. That said it better than I could have, but also shows that Hawke had a good relationship with the Queen and would never insult her. The Crown also confuses the true meaning behind the show's name, Terra Nullius, meaning nobody's country. They use it as a meaning for Australian republicanism, even though it never was and never has been used by the Republican movement.
Terra Nullius. That's what your ancestor, King George III, called us when the Brits first arrived. Nobody's country. Well, by God, we were somebody's country then. And we're our
also quickly just going to point out, even though this doesn't necessarily have anything to do with Bob Hawke, they're supposed to be at the Lodge, which is in Canberra, but we see a massive ocean in the background, which leads me to believe that they've tried to move it to the Kirribilli House, the Prime Minister's home in Sydney, and that's trying to somewhat look like Sydney Cove, Circular Quay, all that sort of stuff. However, that just doesn't make sense. And I understand this was filmed in Spain, but like, you know, come on, guys. You could have easily just green... It looks like a green screen now. You could have easily just green screened in the background of Canberra. It would have been a better effort. The final scene where we see Bob Hawke is in episode 6, and it's supposed to be at the Lodge. We just talked about that. Where he meets Prince Charles and Princess Diana. We don't know what was discussed during this meeting, and since Bob Hawke unfortunately passed away last year, we most likely never will. However, throughout the episode and in this scene, Hawke admits that he hoped the tour would end Australian relationship with the Commonwealth. However, this is highly unlikely, as what was previously mentioned. Hawke didn't see republicanism as a major concern to his government. However, he does say Diana saved the royal tour. Whether or not this is true is up for debate, because you could argue for either side. We do see Hawke a few times later in the series, mainly in the background of the Commonwealth of Nations. In real life, he played a vital role in the sanctions on South Africa and the freeing of Nelson Mandela.
Something is important.
I do think The Crown is a good show, and a good show to watch. And we must remember that this is a show, and liberties have to be taken to make the show more engaging. I just think this episode didn't do Hawke nor Australia justice, and it could have been done better to represent Australia at the time. Australia didn't hate the monarchy. Sure, republicanism was on the rise, but we didn't want to make fun of the royal family and all that sort of stuff. Regardless, The Crown is a good show, and I recommend it to anyone who is interested in the royal family. We just got to remember that sometimes it's not exactly faithful to the history it's trying to tell, and could have been done better. It's nothing major, I just thought it should have been discussed.